If you live in a city, especially a large, densely populated one, chances are you've seen many building exteriors made either mostly or completely out of glass. It's a building style that appeals to some who enjoy the modern, sleek aesthetic. Glazed perimeters also provide a lot of access to natural light, which can be good for health and sustainability. However, there's a hard truth about this type of architecture that's not often talked about. It is estimated that here in North America, between 700 million to 1 billion birds are killed every single year flying into glass facades. I personally love birds, and I'm devastated by statistics like this. But even if you're indifferent or don't like birds, it's still important to recognize that the destruction of wildlife habitat has devastating impacts to our ecosystem that are ultimately harmful to humans. So what are the root causes of this problem, and what can we do to prevent it from happening? Many migratory birds have evolved to fly at night when the temperature is cooler and when they're safer from predators. During flight, birds will use natural cues to navigate, such as light emanating from the moon and stars. Excessive light spilling from urban areas obscures these natural cues. Additionally, many birds are attracted to bright urban lights. This disorients and confuses them, which often results in birds getting trapped in unfamiliar urban environments. Light pollution is also a problem for more than just birds. It disrupts the natural habitat of many animals, contribute to energy waste and economic inefficiencies, and can result in negative health consequences in humans, such as disrupting our natural circadian rhythm. Thus, mitigating light pollution will not only decrease bird fatalities, but also improve the safety and well-being of all animals, including humans. So, why do birds fly into glass? Well, transparent glass is actually highly reflective when viewed from the outside. Since birds cannot distinguish the difference between reflections and real objects, they're highly likely to mistake reflections of the sky, trees, and surrounding habitat as reality, and will attempt to fly into them. Clear transparent glass where the other side can be seen is also dangerous, as birds will attempt to fly through what they perceive to be an opening. This happens a lot at glass skywalks, glass atriums, outdoor glass railings, glass balconies, and perpendicular glass corners. The force of impact when birds strike the glass often result in death. The biggest problem is not even high-rise buildings. While migratory birds usually fly at altitudes of over 500 feet or 150 meters, they tend to descend to much lower altitudes during inclement weather. Additionally, reflections of trees and surrounding natural habitat are worse than reflections of the sky, as they're attractive elements for birds. Thus, low-rise buildings and residential homes actually account for significantly higher rates of bird fatalities than mid and high-rise buildings. Glass collisions also kill birds indiscriminately, regardless of species, size, age, or physical health. Natural hazards tend to kill weaker individuals. However, glass collisions can kill some of the strongest and healthiest birds that would have gone on to produce offspring in the natural environment. So you might be wondering, why does this matter? How do bird fatalities affect us?
Those are great questions, Betty, and they're important questions that come up often when we start looking into human-wildlife conflicts like bird window strikes. Birds are a group of vertebrate animals. Over the course of their evolution, birds have diversified to include everything from ostriches to hummingbirds. And as birds evolved and diversified, they became important members of their home ecosystems. For instance, hummingbirds are important pollinators of certain flowers. Without hummingbirds, these plants wouldn't be able to make seeds. And without birds like cardinals, cedar waxwings, and other songbirds that eat fruits, those seeds wouldn't be distributed across the landscape and able to grow plants of their own. And these are just two jobs that birds can do. Many of the birds I just mentioned are migratory, meaning that they spend part of the year in one geographic location, then travel enormous distances to spend another part of the year somewhere else. Birds migrating across North America are normally moving north to south and vice versa. They spend the winters in the south where it's warm and they can find food, then travel north in the spring and summer in order to breed and raise their families. There are four major flyways across North America, and basically any major metropolitan area you can think of will be in the path of one of these: the Atlantic Flyway, the Mississippi Flyway, the Central Flyway, and the Pacific Flyway. So basically anywhere you go, there will be birds in danger of running into windows.
I live in Toronto, Ontario, where it's estimated at least 1 million birds die every single year due to fatal window collisions. This is disproportionately high compared to other North American cities due to Toronto's position adjacent to Lake Ontario, which is at the confluence of multiple bird migratory flyways. Paired with the fact that it's the fourth most populous city in North America, with hundreds of thousands of low, mid, and high-rise buildings potentially hazardous to flying birds. The good news is that there are a lot of relatively simple and cost-effective solutions to prevent bird fatalities. Lighting is an integral part of life, as it's required for safety, security, and navigation in urban environments at night. Good lighting design should effectively provide for these functions in energy-efficient ways while minimizing negative impacts to humans and animal life. Some of the worst culprits of light pollution are lights that point up or emitting light in all directions, resulting in massive energy loss, as much of the light emitted isn't pointed at where it's needed. Many urban areas are also overlit. For example, most parking lots, sidewalks, and loading docks only require an illumination level of 10 lux at ground or tread level, yet many of these spaces are lit tens or hundreds of times higher than that. Again, this is not only bad for birds, it negatively impacts human circadian rhythms, provide poor illumination, result in excessive glare, which is bad for safety and navigation, renders stargazing impossible in urban areas, and is highly energy inefficient. This is why it's important to reduce lighting to a properly lit level. Exterior lighting fixtures should include cutoff shields and lamps with directional control to reduce lighting loss. Building features should be highlighted with downlighting as opposed to uplighting. Searchlights should not be used during bird migration periods. And automatic control systems like timers, occupant, and motion detectors can be used to automatically turn off lights both inside and outside buildings when not needed. On an individual basis, just by drawing your shades after dark, you can help in reducing light pollution. When it comes to glass, the vast majority of bird collisions are actually caused by untreated reflective and/or transparent glass. One easy strategy is to only use glass with a reflectance value of less than 15% on all exterior surfaces. This will reduce bird collisions to an extent, but won't be able to solve the see-through effect. So this strategy should be combined with other glass treatment solutions, such as applying visual markers through ceramic frit, acid etching, or applied film patterns. This approach still allows the glass to be transparent or translucent, but gives the appearance of a solid surface to birds. Studies have shown that birds will not attempt to fly through horizontal spaces less than 5 centimeters, nor vertical spaces less than 10 centimeters. And patterns covering as little as 5% of the total glass surface can prevent 90% of bird strikes. In addition, visual markers can be used to achieve other design objectives, such as privacy screening, reducing light and heat transmission, and integrating branding. Other glass treatment strategies include using opaque or translucent glass, such as frosted glass, stained glass or glass blocks. UV glass, which absorbs and reflects UV light, are also effective as birds have evolved to perceive UV wavelengths that humans can't. Recessed window designs, balconies, awnings, screens, shutters, and sunshades can also reduce the amount of glass visible to birds, as well as acting as solid visual cues for birds to avoid. These elements help to break up an otherwise monolithic facade, providing amenities to residents and be sustainable solutions in reducing solar heat gain. Another solution is to reduce the overall usage of glass in building envelopes and eliminate glass fly-through conditions. This doesn't mean we have to go back to designing concrete bunkers or windowless facades. A building with a 25% to 40% window area relative to other surfaces is generally considered to be effective in reducing bird fatalities. A low window-to-wall ratio can also improve energy performance of the building by reducing heating and cooling needs. All these glass and lighting strategies, of course, should be used in combination with each other, and to the extent necessary, that does not compromise other important design considerations, including access to natural light, energy requirements, and cost. Over 50% of the world's population now live in urban areas, and the UN estimates that by 2050, that percentage will grow to 66%. This is not necessarily a bad thing. Urbanization have opened up a lot of economic opportunities for people all over the world, and in many ways, high urban density can result in less energy use per capita, resulting in more sustainable outcomes. But it's also important for us to be aware of the ecological impacts of our growth, and how the continuous encroachment and fragmentation of natural natural wildlife habitats can be detrimental to human health and well-being. And it's important to keep in mind that practical, economical, and sustainable solutions are out there. We just have to be aware and diligent enough to implement them.
Thank you so much, everyone, for watching, and thank you, Cheryl, for your help with this video. Cheryl has her own channel, The Roving Naturalist. Why don't you tell us a little bit about your channel?
Sure. So on The Roving Naturalist, I want to answer all of the questions you never knew you had about how humans and the environment interact. I've done videos on animal imagery in gargoyle sculptures and how the border wall in between Mexico and the United States might be affecting wildlife. If these topics sound interesting to you, come check out my channel. The information will be somewhere over here.
Awesome. Thank you so much, and bye.